On the agenda tonight, we're going to be taking a look at Queen's full set from 1985 at the Live Aid concert. Hello, Phil here from Wings of Pegasus, and welcome to another analysis video. If you enjoy this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe. So, this is a video that was requested probably about 3 years ago, maybe even longer than that, when I did look at the performance we're about to look at tonight in not very much detail. It was a very short video, but I did say that I would do the full set at some point, and tonight is the night where we're going to be taking a look at a few things. And I'm going to give you fair warning, I am going to be jumping into this one quite a lot in order to point out those things. So if you want to watch it the whole way through without me interrupting it, there's going to be a link in the description below. As always, the approach of this analysis and this video that I'm going to be doing is looking at how Queen was so good on the day. And I know that there are a lot of other videos on YouTube that just describe them being so good because they were so good. And for me, that's just like saying, how does a bird fly? And just saying that because it goes up in the air. It doesn't really explain things, but they were just so good. But there are so many parts in this performance where, as a musician, and I'm sure other musicians can really understand and have a deep respect for how professional they were, how well rehearsed they were, and all these tiny little details that just went into this performance, just standing head and shoulders above any other. So let's get the guys up on screen, and it's probably going to be a bit biased because, as you can tell from my hair, this is my kind of music and I am a huge fan of Brian May's and just Queen in general. But keep an eye out in the bottom left of the screen. Here, we're 4 seconds into the performance. We end at 21 minutes and 3 seconds. That's going to be really important by the end, and also when I'm explaining things, to keep the time in mind. But let's jump into it. And I'm going to stop it already. I did say I was going to jump in a lot, and this is an example of that, because we've already had the sound check. The way that when we start the video, we have obviously Freddie and Brian skipping on stage, just getting that rapport with the crowd. Everyone is so happy to see these guys up on stage, especially Freddie. He just had this ability to connect with an audience without even saying anything, just with his mannerisms. That's exactly what we had here when they entered the stage. But if you were listening out for it, you'll hear each member of the band testing their equipment. And starting out with, I think, John on bass, John Deacon. He just hits a single note to make sure everything's fine, he's plugged in. And then we hear a few toms being hit by Roger Taylor behind that drum kit. Also listen out for Brian May. He strikes his strings and he's muting the strings, but he's just checking that everything's fine. And then here, finally with Freddie, he just plays through a few octaves on the piano, but he's making sure the levels are fine. And you can see he does that twice and then adjusts the level on top of the piano. So they're having a really quick sound check. The amazing thing about this is we're 36 seconds in and didn't even start at zero. They hadn't come out yet, but they've already tested all their equipment. They know they're good to go. I've just run it back a little bit so you can listen out for each instrument as it is tested. There's the bass, that just that tiny little note. And John plays it really subtly just to make sure everything's fine. There we go, foot pedal check from Roger. Hi-hat. Toms and foot pedal. There, that little sound, I'll take it back. That is Brian just checking his guitar, hitting those muted strings. There, that chink, you can hear the strings there. And now the piano. So again, 27 seconds in, and like I said, they didn't even start at zero. They've already checked that everything is where it needs to be. And if there was a problem, they wouldn't start playing. Much better that than finding out that you start playing and your guitar, you can't hear anything. So they already know that everything's set to go. And this is the other thing about the event, that the turnaround time between bands would have been the most minimal turnaround time you would ever experience as a band because of the event and the fact that everyone's watching it, and you don't just want to be looking at an empty stage on the TV coverage. So they were literally just on and off and on and off in record time, and Queen knew that. So they were so professional with the way that they set up, but let's get into it again. Just to jump in here, to mention about, you would have noticed there the way that Freddie took an extra breath just before singing the end of that phrase that we just listened to. I sometimes wish I'd never been born at all. And when we get into the solo, of course, Brian May, it's very tempting for me to get the guitar out. But if I was starting to demonstrate, like in my other videos, the techniques that Brian's going through here, we would be here for years. So it's going to be just an overall look at the band. But talking about Freddie's vocal, everybody will know that before this gig, he was ill and his doctor said that you shouldn't sing, you can damage your vocal cords. So let's take into consideration that this performance was Freddie on a bad vocal day. And you can hear in certain parts of the performance where he just changes the melody in order to save his vocal a little bit, but you don't notice it because he was so good at changing the melody of a line to another great melody that you just thought, wow, that's such a great line that's slightly different to the album. But he's just understanding exactly where to push his voice and exactly where not to push his voice. So when we're talking about Freddie Mercury as a singer, as somebody whose vocal cords are his main instrument, but we can see him playing piano and he does play guitar later on as well. But the management of his vocal cords, he knew his voice inside out, which meant that he could push it to exactly its limit without overstepping that limit. And as soon as he got close to that, he'd just rein it in a little bit. And this is why, vocally, he's not 100% here, but nobody would notice. You don't notice it when you're watching it because he's still belting out these notes in his chest voice, you know, really going for it. He just belts, even though he's probably not feeling 100% with his vocal cords. But this is the thing about Freddie Mercury, that even a 90% and 95% vocal from Freddie Mercury would just blow everybody else out of the water because of that power that he had. I'm going to get the piano up on screen just really quickly because I want to show you guys the notes that even though he's not 100%, he's still busting out the C5. I think he gets pretty close to that in this performance. He pretty much spends most of his time singing in and around the A4, the B4, the C5, right at the top end of that male tenor range. And he just spends so much time up here. And for anybody with a 100% voice, it would take so much training in order to maintain this kind of range that he sits in. But he still does it in this performance. It's something that people never question. Only if you know that he was told not to sing before this, do you then know that he maybe didn't have his vocals in exactly the right place, that he wasn't feeling 100% with them. But the great thing is that he never took anything out of the performance. He just put everything into it and just gave you everything live all the time. That's the great thing about Queen as a band. They always did that. Every show was as if it was their last, and this is no exception to that. But let's get that piano off screen. Quickly to throw in here as well, I'm going to try and make this video as short as possible, but Queen as a band, as an entity, just the single members of the band, how they were just extremely good players, instrumentalists, and singers in their own right. When I'm talking about Roger Taylor, you'll hear him in the background supplying the lead vocal, but just behind Freddie, so really thickening up with that main vocal line. But also you got Brian May, who's got a great voice in his own right, harmonizing, and then you've got John as well. I mean, the rhythm section has to be tight, I always say that, but Roger and John are always on the same page, super tight. And it's something that, again, you'll see John just adding a little bit of backing vocal in there. So you've got a band with great vocalists independently who have Freddie Mercury at the front of the stage, who is just in a different league vocally. And you've got the fact that these guys, because Freddie Mercury played piano and he could play guitar, it meant that normally when he's at the front of the stage, just with his microphone, instrumentally, they were like a three-piece. You had drums, bass, and a guitar, and then a lead vocal. But instrumentally, there were only three instruments going on. But when you've got Freddie behind the piano, they've now got the full four-piece arrangement there with piano as well as guitar and the drums and bass. And then when you add in the vocals with that and then Freddie's vocal, it means you get such a full sound live. Something else that you'll look out for during this performance is the way that when Freddie leaves that piano and goes to the front of the stage with the microphone, they now have somebody else just off stage playing the piano, low in the mix, but it makes such a difference to the sound, so that they maintain that four-piece sound even though Freddie's now left and he's picking up the microphone. One thing that indicates to you is the fact that Queen knew about the strengths and the strength that they had in Freddie Mercury as a frontman, but also the importance of putting on a show to the crowd, so that even when Freddie went to the front of the stage, they kept the piano element in there. But you don't want to have Freddie Mercury stuck behind a piano for the whole gig. And this goes for just any Queen gig, but let's jump back into it again. And And notice that transition and the fact that the strings have come in. And this is what I said about Freddie now leaving the piano, but they've still got somebody on the keys just filling in that space. And we have that kind of sequencer synthesis sound coming in terms of starting the song off. But you can see the way that Brian and John are looking at Roger to start this track. So they're just looking for that cue. And this is something that they have rehearsed this so much. As you'll notice, you'll really get a deep appreciation of it at the end when we look at the timings, but they have rehearsed this so much. It is faultless the whole way through, but let's get back into it. Listen to the vocals there, doubling up, tripling up on the main line that Freddie sings to get that really thick sound. Great advantage to have Roger Taylor in your band, because he had a great range as well, just being able to reach up to this male tenor range and belt it in chest as well. Also, it sounds like Roger is triggering a sound more like a MIDI sound than hitting the snare during this period of the song. And that might just be off to the right of his drum kit by the looks of it, just triggering that more electric kit sound. So, another thing about the crowd, I don't think any crowd has been as into a performance as with this performance in any performance that I've seen with any band. Everybody is clapping along, and obviously this is just Freddie Mercury. He has that effect on the crowd at this point, just the way that he gets this rapport and he gets everyone involved in the performance. I say in other videos about having that feeling of being on stage with the artist who is performing or with the band, and you certainly get that sense more than any other performance with this one because of the way that Freddie is right at the front of the stage. You can see here that you've got the fallback speakers and he's just as far forward as he can get, to the point where later on he'll be right on the edge. He's really breaking down that gap between the stage and the crowd in order to make it so much more inclusive. And it's something that Freddie Mercury did so well, just being able to connect with a crowd en masse. And when I say en masse, I really mean it here, with Wembley Stadium absolutely packed out. I mean, just look at that shot. If that doesn't say it all, I don't know what does, because of everyone just fixed on Freddie Mercury. And there's just such an inclusive atmosphere and look to this picture that he is the guy that everyone is focused on. And let's just mention the other guys in the band doing such a fantastic job behind the scenes, just keeping everything super tight, but Freddie Mercury just being the absolute cherry on top of the cake. And just the whole band waiting for Freddie Mercury to hit his pose, stand up again, and the tightness of him just twisting around, and that's when they finish the song. It is so tight that it's on a totally different level here. I'm just going to shoehorn into this part of the video talking about the sound and the volume that Queen were playing at here, because we can see the tent where the mixer will be and you have the sound guys in there controlling the mix, but the volume that the crowd are hearing. This is something that was reported after the fact, and people mentioned it on my previous video that I did looking at Queen at Live Aid about them having their own sound guys who then got control of the mixer, and they removed the limiter on the mixer so that Queen were playing at a louder volume compared to the other bands on the day. And to just quickly explain that when you're performing a gig like this and overlooking a gig like this as a sound crew, generally what would happen is that the guys that are looking after all the other bands, the sound guys, they will place a limiter on the output of the PA system. And as you can imagine, the PA system at Wembley Arena would be very loud. So it meant that, say for example, your limit is 0.0 decibels, it means that if you hit that limit, you might start getting distortion, really nasty feedback. And at these kind of events, it's always set up to have more volume than you need. They're always giving themselves headroom so that they're never at the limit, because when you're pushing a sound system to its limit, that's where huge problems crop up with feedback and distortion. And yeah, you just don't want to go there. So when you've got this limit of 0.0, you can set a limit that is at minus 0.2 decibels, which means it gives you a 0.2 headroom of volume effectively. So they might have even had it less than that, maybe minus 0.3, just to make sure that they're never ever getting to that limit of the system. And that's what would have been employed for all the other bands. Whereas when Queen came on stage with their sound guys, reportedly they removed, the sound guys, that limiter on the output channel so they could start to push it close to the limits of the volume of the whole PA system, which, as you can imagine, the difference between 0.1 and 0.2 decibels, when you're sitting in front of your speakers at home, you won't really be able to tell the difference. When you start talking about a system that is designed for Wembley Stadium, you can definitely tell the difference between a 0.1 or a 0.2 decibel change, because it will be so dramatic. So that's what Queen had. It would have been a noticeably louder performance than the other bands. And I'm not saying that because it's louder automatically bands sound better. If it's a bad band and they are louder, it just means that it's going to be worse because it's now louder listening to a bad band. Queen just had that ability to be a fantastic band who were then slightly louder than everybody else. So it just stuck out in that sense as well. But having got all technical, let's get back into it. I'm just going to jump in here. Look at the clock in the background. We can see that it's about 11 or 12 minutes to 7 in the evening, and they started playing at 22. So that means that they're roughly about 8 or 9 minutes into their performance, and they've got, about 11 or 12 minutes left of their performance. It's really important to keep an eye on the time. By the time we get to the end, it'll give you such a deeper appreciation of what these guys are doing.
All right!
Just a quick technical point, that extended section where Freddie's interacting with the crowd, obviously that's just Freddie getting the crowd involved, but also it gives Brian a little bit of time to make sure that he's now got his guitar set up for the next song, to have that little hint of chorus on the sound as well. But let's jump back into it. Listen to those vocals across the whole band, the backing vocals, and Freddie, he's just going for this in his chest voice, and he is so good vocally that it's exactly like the album version of the song, and you could even argue that it's better live because of the energy and the show that he puts into it. And let's just throw in there again that this is Freddie not at 100%, and it sounds ridiculous to say that considering how good this vocal is from Freddie, but across the whole band, the backing vocals, the start of Hammer to Fall here is just so tight, so impressive, so on pitch by everybody. It's just in a totally different league. Listen to Roger again, he's triggering that snare sound because it's more like a punchy, almost like a bullet sound with a bit of reverb after it. It's so punchy, but he's got those options in order just to trigger a sound where he wants to get more aggressive with the snare rather than just relying on the standard snare, just hitting the center of that. It's not going to have that punch to it. Every night, every day, a little piece of you is falling away.
Time for the hammer to fall.
I think Freddie Mercury was the best frontman ever. Well, a lot of people would just say that full stop, but the best frontman ever during guitar solos. Because when the lead guitarist of a band goes to the front of the stage, he is the focus, and sometimes the frontman of the band, if he's just a vocalist, kind of wanders around a little bit. Maybe they just stand in front of the amp and look a little bit disinterested. But not only does Brian May, of course, take your focus because of the lead guitar ability, the way that he plays and going to the front of the stage, but somehow Freddie Mercury enhances the lead solo by being so engaged with the lead solo, playing air guitar. You can see the way that he's holding the mic stand, playing the guitar, pretending to play the guitar in exactly the same way that I think a lot of people in the crowd would be. So again, it's just building that rapport, but you can't take your eyes off this whole band. And that is such a rare thing as well, to just be so engaging, just from a visual perspective, as well as from an auditory perspective. The audio coming at you is so impressive, just pairing all of the top things that you want to hear, you want to see together in one band. So just be wary there of the transition between one song and the next, getting the guitar on stage. And you can see here that he's using a wireless system on this guitar. And one thing that I would say is that the guitar sounds a little bit low level-wise when Freddie starts playing. You can just about hear it, but I think it was probably intended to be a lot louder than we can hear, and that might have been something to do with going wireless and that signal maybe being a little bit weak. Certainly in the early wireless systems, that's something that would happen, that you'd get maybe 80% of the volume going wireless and then you'd go straight in with your lead and then you get 100%. Obviously being connected to the amp is what you want in order to get all of your signal going into it. So there's a little bit of drop in signal here. I think that because Brian's coming in, you're not really going to notice it too much when Brian comes in with his guitar just backing up with the rhythm.
This next song is only dedicated to beautiful people here tonight. It means all of you. Thank you for coming along. and making this a great occasion.
And now here, I mean, we do get a little bit Elvis here with Freddie and that vocal. I love that about this song. But did you notice how Freddie would have realized that his guitar wasn't very loud? So he turns around and he nods his head to give everybody that visual of the timing of how he's playing, because it might have even been the case that the guys on stage couldn't hear his guitar. Whereas, of course, in rehearsals, they would have had it nice and loud so that they can hear that rhythm and just blend themselves in and start the song just in sync with each other. But here, just giving that visual representation meant that they all come in on time. And it's one of those pro moves just to make sure that everybody is on the same page. And sometimes this kind of thing will happen live where your signal cuts out, but you keep the show going. And these guys just totally roll with that punch of not having the volume quite loud enough.
This thing's called up a cloud in a cradle all night is sweet. A giant honey shakes over like a jellyfish. You're gonna like it. Crazy little girl. There goes my baby.
Also, listen out for the piano in the background. This is what is so good about this performance, but Queen, in general, when they performed live, they brought in extra elements that you didn't notice were there until you really listened to it in detail. You could hear the piano going off, and it adds so much to this performance. But because they're so engaging as a band, you're not really analyzing what you're hearing. You're just really enjoying the song and the performance and the vocal. And that's something about Freddie. He was so engaging that you didn't really notice these other instruments coming in. A little bit of keys in the background, a little bit of strings maybe being played on a keyboard as well. So listen out for the piano.
She knows I'm wrong. She drives me crazy. She gives me all over your sweat.
And you can't have a performance without a bit of cowbell in there, and there it was from Roger.
I gotta be cool.
Just listen to Brian May's tasty guitar lines going off in the background. Again, top quality playing, just dashing these great blues lines and faultless playing, control, vibrato, you name it, Brian May's got it.
Take a long ride on my motorbike to the ready. Crazy little thing I love. This thing, come on, I just can't handle this. Come on, I just out of it, baby, love it. Crazy little thing I love. Crazy little thing I love. Hey, crazy little thing.
And there just was a little mistake in there from Brian as he turned round. He just missed the chord towards the end of the song, but you're not going to notice it. This is the point. And I'm not going to point it out because I'm not here to point out mistakes. Because bands, when they are top level, they cover their mistakes so well that the general public, and if you don't play yourself, you won't necessarily notice it. And even if you do play yourself, if you haven't listened to things in real depth, then you might miss it yourself. This is the great thing about bands like Queen, that they could make tiny mistakes here or there, but you weren't aware of them on any level because they're so well hidden. But let's get back into it. Again, just another thing to point out, it's so easy to just watch this and get into it and not analyze anything, but look at the way that Brian there, when he's playing his lead guitar at the end, Freddie isn't standing by Brian because he knows he's got to get over to the piano. They are really on a tight schedule here. So Freddie gets over to the piano so that as soon as he stops his solo with Brian, we're then into the next song.
Time after time, I've done my sentence, but committed no crime, and bad mistakes, I've made a few.
I also love the way that when Freddie's hitting the top note in the chorus there, it is high up and he's still going for it in chest voice here. I love the way that Roger Taylor steps up in order to help Freddie out. He really belts that main chorus melody in the background. And that's what being a band is all about. You've got each other's back, and these guys would always help each other out. You can tell that Freddie on that top note is just a little bit further away from the mic, maybe taking his foot off the accelerator a little bit because, like we've mentioned about him not being 100%, but because he's just a little bit further away, you can hear Roger going for it in the background to fill in that extra bit of space. You always got the best sound possible because these guys just had that luxury of having great vocalists throughout the whole band. So it meant that when one person wanted to take a little bit of a break or was a little bit further away from the mic, another one could step in and just belt out that chorus vocal.
I've taken my bow. My curtain calls. You brought me fame and fortune and everything that goes with it. I thank you all. But it's been a bed of roses. No pleasure cruise. I consider it a challenge.
And there we have it. So, something that I'm going to point out now that's going to absolutely blow your minds is the fact that these guys had that limit of 20 minutes for their set. And by the way, starting with your biggest, I think everybody probably thought that Bohemian Rhapsody would be at the end of the set, but starting with that song was just a masterstroke in itself, just hitting everyone right between the eyes as soon as you start your set. But anyway, the fact that we started at about 36 seconds, I think it was, going back to the beginning of the video, as I said, to keep an eye on the bottom left of the screen. So 36 seconds is where we started, and I'm just going to make sure that that was correct, and it was. And we're ending at 20 minutes and 48 seconds. So technically, it actually ended, if we go with that final cymbal and the final foot pedal from Roger, it was 20 minutes and 46 seconds. So that means that they were 10 seconds off 20 minutes, and 20 minutes was their set time. So I'm sure that if you also factored in the entrance of the stage, that they were probably dead on. Anyway, why is this so impressive? Okay, so now we rewind back through the whole set, starting from the beginning, knowing that they're only on stage for 20 minutes. That is their limit, and they have to be off stage quickly because of the turnarounds. They can't afford to overrun. So it means that Queen not only have broken down each of their songs so that they're not the full length of the album track, they've got them down in order to fit as many songs in as possible that last no longer than 20 minutes. So, when we go back and we think about when Freddie was interacting with the crowd and getting them to repeat everything that he was saying, he is doing that in exactly the right time frame for exactly as long as possible and is needed in order to have the overall set being 20 minutes. So, you can think that is massively impressive to even know how long to interact with a crowd for, it means that they're doing every ending when you get the crashes and just extending the ending before Freddy jumps up and spins round and they stop the song. That is to the second. And then, just to blow your minds even further, it means that Roger Taylor's tempo for the whole set was only out by a maximum of 10 seconds in a 20-minute set. That is so solid from a rhythmic perspective. Even keeping one song to within 10 seconds of the album version is impressive. But to be able to drum so consistently with that kind of tempo that you don't run over your 20-minute set time by anything more than 10 seconds is just insane. So what I'm saying at the end of this video is that you can sit back, you can enjoy this, just watch the 20-minute set and just appreciate for the art that it is. But on a deeper level, you can have so much appreciation for the professionalism of these guys, how much they've rehearsed, and how accurate they are, that when you scratch beneath the surface, it now becomes infinitely more impressive to be able to perform at this level, but to the second. They know they've only got 20 minutes, and they've absolutely nailed this dead on, right between the eyes, almost to the second. And like I said, you could probably argue 10 seconds either way with the entrance onto the stage and having to go through just testing their equipment to make sure it's all on. You could say that they could have saved 10 seconds there, so I wouldn't be surprised at all. I mean, Brian May is one of those guys that he's effectively an astrophysicist, a rocket scientist. He would have this down to the second. So I know that everyone just says, well, Queen were just great, and this performance was great because they were just so great. But when you really scratch beneath that surface, as I said, you can get such a deeper appreciation that these guys were great because they were so well rehearsed. You have got to get an appreciation of how much this performance isn't just down to them being great and being talented. It's a hell of a lot of hard work. Every single band member knowing the other band member inside out, being so tight as a unit, just covering each other. It is a team, and you're only as strong as your weakest link. And with Queen, there was no weak link. That is the point. I never really looked at it in this detail to see how precise they were. And I'd seen that video of them rehearsing for this, and it really puts that into perspective that they were nailing down not only the songs, not only the tempo, but the amount of time between the songs and switching. Again, it just blows your mind even more. Switching from the mic, getting the guitar on, all of this time has been accounted for by the band. So it's one of those performances, even just watching it for the millionth time, you still get goosebumps because it is so good. But yeah, it is so good on every single level that you break it down. Every single layer as a musician, as just a fan of the band, it just is entirely impressive. No matter how deeply you look into it, it gets more impressive the more you look into it. But thank you guys for requesting this analysis video. And keep those requests coming in the comments below. Let me know what you guys think. If you did enjoy this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe. And I'll see you guys at the next one. Rock!